July 2021.
Man, where'd all this water come from?
In Germany, the worst flooding in over a century.
These events will occur more frequently, that's for sure.
Thousands lost their homes.
With the first anniversary, now it's like you fall into a kind of trance. You see it all happening, all over again.
Still visible, the destruction wrought by the flood. On the day of the flood, Bad Münstereifel's historic old town was deluged. A year later, reconstruction and repair work here is ongoing. Tourists are starting to return, though they have to watch where they walk. Gradually, businesses and shops are reopening. A year ago, small rivers like this one became raging torrents within hours. July 13th, 2021, the whole day, the rain came down in droves.
It was a catastrophe, because it went so far beyond anything we'd experienced before. Water level records were completely shattered, even the gauges were pulverized.
The previous day, Germany's weather service had issued warnings. They notified district authorities and fire departments about dangerously high water levels.
Attention, expect lots of rain in the coming days. River water levels, which are already quite high for this time of year, will rise. Many places, especially in western Rhineland-Palatinate, will see 100 litres per square metre and more. At its peak, 150 to 200 litres per square metre. So the water rose from 80 centimetres to not just 3 or 4 metres like we'd seen before, but to 9 metres.
At noon, further advisories followed.
Localized rainfall of over 200 liters per square meter can't be ruled out.
It was a disaster just waiting to happen, especially along smaller rivers. 11 p.m. The storm front moved away from Altena in the Sauerland towards Hagen. In the next 3 hours alone, this area received twice as much rain as it normally does in an entire month. The Volme overflowed its banks and flooded the streets. The Lenne did the same. Just after midnight, an alarm went out to Hagen's volunteer fire brigade.
Hundreds of emergency calls were coming in, and you didn't know where to start.
A river was already running down the street, and there was a woman stuck in a gully. We were supposed to drive somewhere else. That's how it started.
Even the bridges sank, and it never stopped raining for the next 20 hours.
I wanted to go get some cigarettes. Suddenly I found myself stuck in the water. I couldn't get away.
At 2 in the morning, the crisis management team met in Hagen. Their assessment, even with 500 rescue workers on deck, the situation was already out of control.
People radioed the control center saying, we need a boat. They just didn't know what we were dealing with up here.
Wednesday, July 14th. When dawn broke, the scale of the devastation became clear.
Nothing will be happening here for a few days. I'm pretty sure about that. It's crazy, just crazy.
And the rain continued. The Volme River flowed through the entire city.
The water kept rising, and with it the time pressure. Buildings verged on collapse. They had cracks and parts missing.
Hagen Hohenlimburg was in a state of constant alarm.
They radioed us and said, go up there and help rescue people. I saw a mother with a crying child screaming, what should we do? Help us.
They were really scared and stood by the windows in despair. I could only rescue 3 or 4 people, bring them in and head out on the next round. Folks would be standing by windows with kids, babies, waving and yelling they wanted out.
While people in North Rhine-Westphalia were trying to stem the floodwaters any way they could, on the River Ahr, things were still quite calm. Cornelia Weigand, then mayor of the collective municipality of Altena, followed the river to the town hall. She'd heard the weather warnings.
At 9 a.m. on that terrible day, the water level was still 90 centimeters. I thought, okay, we've come through the first night relatively unscathed.
At 9:24 a.m., the State Environmental Office announced that the Ahr River's water level was expected to triple in the coming night, to 2.4 metres, creating a perilous situation for the village of Schult in the Eifel too.
Es war insofern anders, dass es ununterbrochen seit morgens früh schon am Regnen war.
It was different in that it had rained like cats and dogs non-stop since the early morning. It gave you an odd feeling, because even the tributaries from the valleys had turned into monstrous rivers. We'd never seen anything on that scale before.
Schult was practically wiped off the map. The whole village was engulfed. It hasn't recovered from the flooding to this day.
Looking at the place today, you sometimes can't tell where the streets ran or how it used to be.
The floodwaters backed up at the bridge. A pizzeria, the local meeting place, once stood by the riverbank. Across from it was the bakery. Today, there's nowhere to buy food in Schult. July 14th, 12:24 p.m. The State Environmental Office raised its high water advisory to 3.3 metres, and the German Weather Service issued a storm warning for 37 districts, citing extremely abundant continuous rainfall that would mainly affect small rivers and streams.
Watch out for rivers. They can get real dangerous.
Aber das Entscheidende ist dann, wie breitet sich das Regengebiet aus?
But the decisive thing is then, where does this rainwater go? And what happened here was that very small rivers all drained into the Ahr, the Erft, or other rivers in the Sauerland at the same time. So these flood waves all came together and just kept on rising.
At 2:34 p.m., Ahrweiler's district authority warned the population by app to expect localized flooding. Not an hour later, the State Environmental Office made an alarming projection. Altena's water level gauge would read 5.19 metres.
That was a shock. None of us had any experience with this kind of forecast or these kinds of water levels. It hadn't happened in a century or more. My deputy fire chief looked at me and I asked him, as mayor, what can I do? He said, Frau Weigand, declare a state of emergency.
Declaring a state of emergency would have given people time to save some of their belongings. Even now, a year later, Altena's hotels still lie in ruins. On July 14th, 2021, fire brigades everywhere were battling the waters. In the Eifel too, streets started to flood. In Bad Münstereifel, the River Erft had been rising steadily since morning. By the afternoon, conditions had far surpassed all the weather warnings. Dramatic reports were also coming in from Altena in the Sauerland. After rescuing someone, a fireman was himself swept away and drowned.
Oh my God!
The floodwaters had begun to claim lives. 2 hours later, another firefighter died while on duty. Yet another was luckier. People were able to pull him out of the water in time. In Stolberg bei Aachen, there was also a last-minute rescue. In Altena, Cornelia Weigand was worried. The expected high water mark was 5.19 metres. At 4:20 in the afternoon, she called her district's administrative head.
Please declare a state of emergency. They said, just a moment, we'll call you back. They called back, we need a bit more data. We have to verify something. It'll take a while. That was the last we heard.
At 5:40 p.m., the crisis management team of Bad Neuenahr-Ahrweiler's district authority met. The district head could have sounded the alarm then, but he didn't.
And then, in the evening and the night, for as long as mobile radio and cellular service kept working, emergency calls poured in. Afterwards, we realized that many people were out on their roofs. And the whole night, there were no helicopters. That was an awful night.
Today, Weigand has taken over as the new administrative head of the Ahrweiler district. If needed, she can declare a state of emergency herself. 6 p.m. on July 14th, 2021. In North Rhine-Westphalia, the rain was coming down harder than ever. Rheinbach was plunged into chaos as flash floods hit its town centre. In Bad Münstereifel, the Erft turned into a raging torrent. It devastated the historic old town. ...6:42 p.m. 8 kilometres further east, on the evening of July 14th, the Steinbachtal Dam was in danger of overflowing and flooding entire villages. A good hour later, the dam began to overflow. 120,000 litres of water poured over per second. It was feared the dam would break. Meanwhile, 20 kilometres to the south in the Ahr Valley, the mayor of the village of Schult, Helmut Lussi, suspected what was heading their way.
The floodwaters had risen by a meter within the hour. You could see how the homes were being steadily inundated and, in parts, demolished.
A campsite right on the Ahr River was the first place affected. Dozens of trailers and wood cabins were swept away by the floodwaters.
The owner warned everyone. She got them out of their mobile homes and told them that they had to get away from here. She said that something unprecedented was happening. Thanks to her, no lives were lost.
More than 100 homes were carried away. The residential campers still haven't been allowed to rebuild. Only dwellings that can be cleared within an hour are permitted.
This incredible amount of rain had to pass through these confined spaces. Just look at the valleys with their bottlenecks. Then Bernoulli's principle comes into play. Lots of water must pass through a narrow space. The only way to get that amount through is to increase its speed, which leads to these torrential floodwaters. They went so high that trees were uprooted, parts of buildings broke off and were washed away with the river. Then comes the first bridge. Everything gets clogged up and the force grows stronger. So this combination of things, that was decisive.
7 p.m. At the Ahrweiler district's crisis centre, they'd yet to feel the flood's impact. The alarm signals from Schult and Altena never arrived, as digital phone and radio networks had gone down. The district administrator met with Rhineland-Palatinate's interior minister, who left the meeting thinking the situation was under control. So no warning went out to the local population, who still would have had time to get to safety.
I honestly have to say that our district administrator completely mishandled things. I accuse him of not reacting properly, even though he'd been given enough early warning.
At the time, Altena's water level gauge read 3.92 meters, but the number just kept rising. Just before 8 p.m., the State Environmental Office upped its projection to 5.3 meters. Entire homes floated down the Ahr. The river rose to more than 8 meters, and Schult went under.
That night you could see the village dying a slow death.
Now there was nothing anyone could do. The volunteer fire brigade were powerless to help. That evening, Altenburg also flooded. Altena is just a few hundred meters downstream. Lukas Seermann's wine-growing estate is located here, right on the Ahr River. Seermann and his father hoped to save a few machines in the wine press hall.
Meanwhile, the floodwater warning had risen to over 4 meters, in parts close to 5. So we put everything that couldn't get wet up high. There's a loft in the hall.
At 8:45 p.m., Altena's water level gauge read 5.75 meters. Soon afterwards, the gauge was washed away, along with the whole building. Lukas Seermann had to abandon his hall. The water had torn off the entire wall facing the river. 40 full barrels of wine and 25,000 bottles were carried off into the floodwaters and disappeared. Even his winery was no longer safe.
We had to get out of here right away, otherwise the water would have come down here and we wouldn't have gotten back up the ramp. We'd have been forced down into the garage where we would have drowned.
At the last minute, he and his father sought refuge on the balcony of the ice cream parlor two houses down. It was the highest spot on their street. And still, there was no official warning from the crisis center in Bad Neuenahr. Today, Seermann is back in the winemaking business. He got to work straight away.
I spent lots of time talking with architects and tradespeople. I must say I no longer feel like a vintner. Or let's put it this way, it was like taking a course in construction.
At least he could rebuild. Just a meter away, there's a new flood zone that must remain vacant.
I'm proud of what we've already achieved together, and I think we should be. It's motivating not just to look at what's still missing, but to see what's already here. The flood itself is gone, but there's no getting away from it here. There are ruins in many places still. It's annoying, and you wonder why here and there nothing's been done. Those who wanted to rebuild have done it or are in the last stages. And those who haven't just don't want to.
There's still work to be done in Altena. July 14th, 40 kilometers further north in Erftstadt-Blessem. It was almost 10 p.m. and water already covered the floor of the riding arena at Anna Spohr's Feltenhof. For 2 hours, people formed a human chain and bailed to try to keep the water away from the stables. 60 horses stood there in the stalls.
Then so much water rushed in. Fighting it was pointless. It came in from all sides, and the first stalls filled with water.
In the Ahr Valley, the floodwaters had already ravaged Maischoss and Rech. Around 10 p.m., they reached Dernau, a village of close to 1,800 residents.
We want to take everything upstairs.
More's coming. It's breaking through everything.
Lord in heaven! Lord in heaven!
People scrambled to upper stories or onto rooftops.
I regret taking the things upstairs and not climbing the hill to the vineyard. You felt so naive in that situation. The water just kept rising. The terrace was full too.
The water started creeping up the building walls.
We're on the third floor. How high will it go? What if we have to swim? How do we do that? What if we have to climb? How do we do that? Where do we climb to? And in the end, we're just powerless. And then, honestly, we just prayed.
Only at 10.04 p.m. did the crisis management team call a red alert. The floodwaters kept streaming towards Bad Neuenahr, where the crisis management team was sitting in a basement with an unstable mobile phone network. Half an hour before midnight, a huge wave of water hit the town. Its citizens were completely unprepared.
The door to our home burst open and the water rushed in here. A minute before, it was still this high. Then the water came and forced the door open. My girlfriend went flying through the apartment, followed by the cupboard. We were almost killed.
At 2:30 a.m., water was also surging through Zinzig. Based on old plans, they'd evacuated people living within 50 meters of the Ahr. Floodwaters had never gone further than that. So no one had given much thought to the disabled residents of the Lebenshilfe House, located 250 meters away from the river.
Help, we're drowning here. Can anyone hear us? We called back. But it was just incredible. We called the fire department. They knew about it and probably tried to get here, but the water came so quickly.
2:40 a.m. A single soul on night duty managed to bring 8 of the 20 people from the ground floor to upper levels. After that, the doors would no longer open.
Our neighbors. They couldn't do anything more. They had to wait till the water receded to open the doors. By then, it was foreseeable what they'd find.
12 of the home's residents died. By now, shocking images of the floods were circulating on the internet.
I'm an early riser, and at 4 or 5 a.m., I was writing back and forth with a friend. He wrote, "Have you heard? The Ahr Valley looks quite hard hit." At some point, he said, "I'm going there now. I'll take a front-end loader and 5 people with chainsaws, because they'll surely need help. Let's meet up there."
Markus Wipperfurt's agricultural social media channel had 70,000 followers. Over the next few months, many of his followers saw his call for help and wanted to lend a hand.
If you want to come and help, please do. Otherwise, folks who want to help should look where the Ahr runs. There's work to be done everywhere, lots of it. Here come a bunch of farmers. Look how far back it goes. It's a convoy. From the Westerwald for Ahrweiler. People who'd spent the entire night driving here with their tractors got to work right away. They'd sit on their tractor or digger 24 hours straight and keep on going. We were full of adrenaline. No one could stop. We knew we had to press on because maybe we'd still find someone somewhere. Today, 2 more people were rescued here, thank goodness.
Back at the stables in Erftstadt, the water was now 1.5 meters deep, but they still didn't dare to lead the horses through it.
Waiting till it got light, that was the worst time.
Then the water rose quickly.
By then it was so high there was nothing left to consider. It was clear we must leave now. And when we decided to go and opened all the stalls, really everyone, all the people who were there, helped. People led horses out who'd never laid hands on a horse before. I was guiding a horse when a door came flying at me. I saw it coming, but with the rain in your hands and the high water, I tried to dodge it. I still don't know how we made it.
They managed to save the animals' lives, but where could they find shelter for 60 horses? Luckily, Anna Spohr didn't have to look far.
There was no time to be choosy, so we were quite lucky to get this place. This is a mining region, and they were set to begin excavating here. Otherwise, it certainly wouldn't have been standing empty. But that's how we found accommodation so fast.
The flood left its mark on the horses, too.
Before, I'd have said they don't take much notice. But many who used to be loners now no longer want to be alone. They'll start to call one another, to whinny. And when one horse leaves, they get much louder. Many can no longer be alone in the stall, which never used to be a problem, when taking other horses out. More and more don't want to be on their own.
July 15th, 2021, 6:58 a.m. At dawn, the damage to the Steinbachtal dam became clearly visible. The dam was in danger of bursting. Surrounding villages were evacuated. Germany's Federal Agency for Technical Relief pumped water to reduce the pressure. At 8:50 a.m., there was also a red alert in Erftstadt. Highway 61 was flooded and partly eroded by the floodwaters. Traffic was rerouted to the B265, Luxembourg Street, a big mistake. At 11 a.m. a flash flood hit the B265. It acted like a kind of funnel. The high waters of the Erft gushed onto the road, covering a 1 kilometer stretch in minutes. The water was 14 meters deep in places and swallowed up more than 100 vehicles.
You just got out?
In reverse.
The water rose within seconds to 1.5 meters.
We couldn't get away. We stood on the bridge over Luxembourg Street and saw drivers lying on their roofs of their trucks and waving. And we thought, God, it's not over yet.
The Ahr Valley was a scene of devastation. There was no way of reaching the area by road. In the morning, 4 deaths were reported. More than 1,000 people were missing.
In the meantime, I'm scared the house won't hold out, because one over there has really been eaten away. It's a wonder we're still alive.
50 people were still stranded on their rooftops after waiting the whole night for helicopters that never came. But in the morning, the police and the German military flew constant rescue missions. In Dernau too.
They came down in pairs and airlifted the 4 of us up to the vineyard in 15 minutes. We just hung from the cable. Zap. Dropped us off, picked up the next one, zap. I'm free. I was just carried over by helicopter. I started running right away in my socks, first to my husband. I looked for him and ran to him calling, Jonas! Then I cried in his arms.
Rescuers searched for survivors everywhere, often risking their own lives in the process. At the same time, the police began combing the riverbanks for bodies, so residents wouldn't have to find their relatives or neighbours themselves. But that couldn't always be avoided.
She was lying here in the corner. We covered her body and called emergency. The policeman said, "We can't keep up with the dead."
Back at the Steinbachtal Dam, they were still trying to pump water. The reservoir's bottom outlet was blocked. That meant that the water couldn't be released in a controlled manner. Trying to clear the blockage meant risking life and limb.
I was asked, "Would you do it with an excavator?" I said, I'll have to think about it. Let's go up and take a look. And standing up there, I said, we'll do it.
18 meters below the waterline, the then 67-year-old unblocked the outlet with his digger, knowing that the dam could burst at any time.
I said, it won't break, and it didn't. We were lucky. I was so happy that the folks who hadn't been able to or couldn't help themselves would now be freed. From then on, with every passing hour, the water would drain away, reducing the risk of a dam breach.
In the meantime, Erftstadt was being evacuated. 15,000 firefighters and emergency responders were on duty. Still, the situation was growing worse by the minute. A dam had been holding back much of the water, but now it had been breached. A huge gravel quarry on the edge of town was deluged by the Erft. The sides of the pit eroded and slid down, creating a giant sinkhole. Early in the morning on July 16th, the rim of the gravel quarry collapsed, taking several buildings along with it. Part of the riding arena also plunged into the abyss.
My husband got up and yelled, "Come look, Astrid, the front of that building's gone. The other homes, all gone."
At the time, no one knew if there were people in those houses. The next morning, on the B265 near Erftstadt, rescue workers searched for possible victims. But all the drivers and passengers had managed to escape. Miraculously, everyone survived the collapse at the gravel quarry. But 69 people perished in Bad Neuenahr alone. Altogether, the floods claimed the lives of 184 people in Rhineland-Palatinate and North Rhine-Westphalia. Once the floodwaters receded, the big cleanup began. Help came from all across Germany. Homes, cellars and streets were all full of sludge that reeked of oil and human waste. Thousands of people travelled to the affected areas.
Then it started with the bucket brigades and these really young people who were suddenly here. My heart rejoiced because everyone saw and understood the problems.
But at first, it wasn't easy to reach the work sites. The few roads that hadn't been destroyed were quickly jammed with traffic, until an event manager from Bad Neuenahr came up with a plan.
The idea came to me on the Saturday after the disaster. We started calling around, and 24 hours later on Sunday, we went down into the valley with the first 300 helpers. And that number increased tenfold in just 7 days. A week later, we drove down with 3,000 helpers in one day.
Over the next few weeks, the helper shuttle idea grew into a large and well-equipped camp.
Right now, it doesn't matter who you call. They're ready to go. The willingness to help is incredible. In the mornings, bus operators are standing here without even having been asked. They just hear about it and arrive with a huge bus saying, "I'm here to lend a hand. I want to help."
And help they did, in every way possible. Many helpers also functioned as counselors. They listened when people told them how they'd lost everything. Sometimes even their loved ones.
Time and again in the evenings, grown men would get teary-eyed. They'd say, "I wanted to come and help, but I could never have imagined what awaited me here." We heard the stories of what happened to people that night, reports of neighbors who'd been defying death for hours, and then were swept away, crying for help. Those are things you don't get over so quickly.
Letzten Samstag war so ein besonderer Tag, da habe ich geheult.
Last Saturday was such an unusual day. I cried my eyes out because last week I'd had a few experiences and heard some stories, like about a kid who hasn't spoken a word in 7 weeks after witnessing his parents drown. I came back in the evening and was really shattered, so we decided to cancel our vacation and stay here for the 14 days and just help wherever we can.
The sense of solidarity in the tent camp kept people strong, and group activities helped keep morale high.
I had a lot of people who sacrificed their summer holidays. They'd come on the last day and say, "Sorry, Mark, I have to go back to work." And you'd think, hey, for heaven's sake, of course, many thanks for coming. 2 days later, they'd be back saying, I can't bear to be at home. I can't keep doing my normal office job knowing that folks down there in the Ahr Valley still need help.
Once the debris was cleared away, the wet plaster had to be removed.
Before the flood, many older people didn't have much use for the younger generation. But now they're suddenly experiencing that it's precisely these young people who are standing with them in the bucket brigade, who work without a break and keep on for an hour past quitting time. And they're fascinated by what these young people are doing here. This young generation wants to do something meaningful.
At the end of May, the last group of helpers arrived at the camp. After they left, it closed down. Now it was craftsmen and specialists whose services were required. In the spring, a major initiative was launched to create 400 gardens for local residents.
It was less about planting flowers in people's gardens than doing something for their hearts and souls. Because basically for months, all people had seen was this brown sludge. And it just makes a huge difference when you get up in the morning and look out the window and it's green and colourful again, or if you keep seeing this brown soup. Really, every weekend we looked into the eyes of people who cried for joy because there was something nice, something green in their garden again.
It brings tears to my eyes to see such young people helping out. It makes me weep.
I see the residents. There's still so much to do, yet they're pleased by the smallest things.
Today, helpers are still being sought and found via an online platform. Now disbanded, the camp was a great success. Rebecca Arnoldi's house is slated to be torn down. For now, she's turned it into a symbol of hope.
At first, it was just something for my soul. And then I saw right away how many other people it helped. Right at the start, someone stopped and thanked me. Thanks for painting that. I've seen so much crap here. Thanks for giving me hope. And that was so cool.
Now it's known as the Flut Kunsthaus, or Flood House of Art. Passers-by can scan a QR code and find many other painting projects here. Dernau is also home to Lukas Seermann's vineyards. His winery is located in Altena, and he filmed the devastation the floodwaters wrought there.
I went live again, I think, on Instagram or Facebook. I don't remember anymore. It was so crazy. I went live and I wanted to say something. I couldn't. The whole time I showed the water, that I'm standing in water, looking away, and thought, what should I do now? And then I just posted it and said, we're sunk. Starting now, let's meet at 9 each morning.
Thanks to many helping hands, vintner Lukas Seermann is back in business, with new barrels and cauldrons in his wine press hall and a new outlook on life.
The flood brought freedom too. Not to sound disrespectful, but since you have to redo things, you can make them the way you've always wanted.
Lukas Zimmermann has created a little piece of paradise around his new wine press hall. Here, his family serves up their own vintages and tasty food to regular customers and hikers. They all love the Ahr Valley.
The steak? Bon appetit. Then there's the Riesling. It's quite crisp this year due to the heavy rains.
Hopefully, the surrounding area will soon look this nice again too. What should stay and what should go?
We need to think about tourism too.
In Bad Neuenahr, this pedestrian bridge was upended and washed away by the floodwaters. Is it worth keeping as a memorial? People here are thinking about it.
You can't just haul it away and scrap it. Those who come after us should be able to see what's happened here.
Meanwhile, the Spohr-Zumela family are returning home to Blessem.
That's always been our wish, though it was unrealistic given its size. Now we're thinking of having just half as many horses. Before there were 62, now we're planning on just 35, in the hope we can go back home.
The gravel quarry has shut down. The sinkholes are being filled with sand. But it will likely take 8 more years before the current plans are fully realised. With new stalls and a new arena, so daughter Paulina can continue her riding exercises in Blessem. In the Ahr Valley too, rebuilding will take years.
I imagined the reconstruction would be completed in 4 years, but that hope is fading fast. I'd say it will take 6 or 7 years.
1 year after the catastrophic floods, nothing is the same as it was. Everywhere here, people continue to improvise and practice patience. They keep hoping that one day, life here will be as good as it used to be, or maybe even better.